Amen. Well, waiting is hard for all of us, no matter how old or young we are. Waiting is just not our favorite. Waiting is something that I've heard it said, never pray for patience because God will put you in a long line. But the truth is, waiting is just something that we struggle with. In fact, I wanted to show you a quick video. My family, Mael, Titus, and Tate, we were golfing in Pasco, Washington about 3 years ago. And Titus was up to golf, and Tate was excited, but he was not ready to wait. And this is what Tate decided to do.
Hit the ball already.
Now don't, poke your spouse and say, come on, I've been telling you, get ready. But the truth is, we don't like to wait. Now, in today's passage, come on, somebody, I don't like to wait. Hit the ball already. In today's scripture verse, we're going to be in John chapter 11. And it's a really important passage because the context surrounding it is one of the most incredible miracles that we're going to see in Scripture. Jesus raises somebody from the dead. That's pretty exciting if you ask me. But in order for this to happen, or not in order for them, but while this is going to happen, while they're wanting this to happen, there's a lot of waiting. And there's two sisters, Mary and Martha. They are waiting for Jesus. I don't know if you can relate to this, but sometimes waiting for Jesus is not always easy. There's that classic church saying, have you ever heard this one? God is never late. He's always, but he's never on my time. At least it feels like that. Am I the only one that feels like that? No? Okay. But God has it all worked out perfectly for us. And as we're waiting, I believe God wants to do something inside of every single person here. I believe one of the things he wants to change in us is that we grow in our trust and dependence on him. But is that easy? No! It's not easy. Why? Because we are people that love a microwave. Anybody else stare at your microwave and like kind of tap your foot? You've never thought 30 seconds could go so slow. But for some reason, there's just something about us that wants things to happen. But I want you to hear this. That oftentimes we think that waiting is a delay. And the problem is, when there's a delay, people think they're being denied. Oftentimes, and I wrote this down in the notes, it should come up here. When things are delayed, just because you're delayed, it doesn't mean you're denied. In fact, if you look in the scripture, David was anointed as king, but he didn't get to be king for 15 years. Joseph had a dream that his brothers would bow down to him, and he made the mistake of telling them that, by the way. It took 22 years for that dream to come true. And if that wasn't long enough, did you know that it took Mael 25 years to marry me? Wow. From the day I was born to the day we got married, it was 25 years. I waited a long time. I'm so glad she said yes. But the truth is, when we are in a delay, oftentimes in our spirits, we think it's a denial. We think we're rejected. And haven't you ever prayed prayers like, God, don't you hear me? Where are you? This hurts. I'm longing for something to change. Now, don't nudge that person next to you. I'm longing for them to change. I'm longing for them to finally see the truth. And we get discouraged, don't we? We start thinking, God, why? Where are you? Are you denying my prayer request? And it's in this is exactly the moment where we pick up the story in John chapter 11 because Mary and Martha, their brother Lazarus, is very sick. And I love what they do, and I think this is such an important thing, is that in your waiting, it doesn't have to be wasted. It says that they sent a letter to Jesus. Now, sending a letter can oftentimes, maybe in today's like terminology, maybe if you journal or you pray or you write down, one of the best things that you can do is develop your prayer life while you're waiting. You can actually grow closer to Jesus while you're waiting for your answer. Because I don't know if you're like me, but many times what needs to change is not just my situation, it's actually me. God needs me to start seeing things a little different because the answer doesn't always look the way that I wanted it to look. And I want to encourage somebody today that you might feel like, or maybe you are, in a delayed season, but God is not denying you. He's shaping you. God is not denying you. He's shaping you. He wants to grow you. He wants you to be stronger. He wants you to be more filled with faith, hope, and love. Why? Because he's all about transformation. So if you're delayed this morning, I want to encourage you, maybe you're not denied. It's still on its way. So Jesus receives this letter, and I want to pick up the story. If you have your Bibles, we're going to fast forward a little bit to John 11:17. That's where we're going to pick up, and Jesus got this letter, and it says this, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. So it says earlier that when he got the letter, he was sick for two. It took him 2 days to come, so a total of 4 days. Jesus did not show up at the right time if you're Mary or Martha, right? So now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed home. I think Mary was a little offended. Anybody else? She stayed at home. And Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, this is good news. Your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, this is the fifth I am. You ready? This is the part that we should be so excited about. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. She's looking for an event. Jesus says, it's actually a person. It's me. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And he asked this question that we should all ask ourselves, do you believe this? Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into this world. How many of you are thankful that Jesus is the resurrection and the life? Come on. Anybody else thankful? Anybody else got some hope today? I have family in heaven that I cannot wait to see. Why? Because of my hope in Jesus. Anybody else got some family in heaven you can't wait to see? Anybody got some friends? You see, it gives us hope, doesn't it? It changes everything because we don't live through this life despair and sad. We actually have hope. The big idea this morning, it's probably the most simple one and easiest one I've ever came up with. Why? Because it's Jesus' words. I am the resurrection and the life. I was trying to come up with something fancy, something cute, something sweet, and I just thought, let's just leave it with what Jesus said. Anybody else think that's a good idea sometimes? Let's just leave it what Jesus said. I am the resurrection and the life. If there's anything I want you to walk away with today is this new found confidence, maybe even greater confidence, that he is the resurrection and the life. Amen. Whatever you're facing today, you've got hope. It's not over. The story's not over. He's not done with you. He's not done with your family. Even in death, he's not done. That's how good our God is. This past week, we were at devotions with the staff, and I asked them, hey, I'm preaching about the resurrection of life, and I want you to add, like, I want you to tell me, when you think of the resurrection, what do you think of? What images come to mind? Because the truth is, we live in a culture, and maybe you don't know this, or actually we all know this, but we don't always recognize it, is that we live in a culture that's fighting to tell the story of what happens after you die. Do you know that? Just watch a Disney movie. All dogs go to heaven. The Lion King, balls of gas burning miles and miles away. That's where all the great kings live. Star Wars, they come back as little, I don't even know what they were. Anyways, not just movies, but philosophy and literature. People are fighting to tell a story of what happens. And as a church and as believers, it's so imperative that we find out the truth of the resurrection, what it will look like someday, from Scripture, not from entertainment. It sounds so silly, but you ask kids, what does it look like? And they have all kinds of different things, don't they? So we're asking the staff, and one of them said, you know, when I was a kid, I thought the resurrection is like heaven, that it would look like, remember that board game Candyland? So I brought up a picture of you, and he said that, you know, the very top, and I want to zoom in for you, that's heaven to this person when they were a child. Lots of candy. Get candy, get candy, get candy, get candy. And then another person was talking about when they get to heaven, that they would get a huge house, and some people were talking about a lake, or like streets of gold, and all these different things that they'd heard or thought. And what was so interesting to me is it took a little bit, but they didn't actually talk about what happens to you and me at the resurrection. In other words, what will we look like? What will we sound like? Will we be, because here's the truth. I think one of the greatest things that Satan has done is gotten people to believe that heaven will be boring and will be like chubby little angels up on a cloud with little harps and stuff, and we'll just be sitting there staring in the clouds. I'm serious. People, you hear the jokes with people, I'd rather go to hell and have fun than to heaven and be bored. Do you see what we're fighting for here, church? And we have students in the back, which I love that you're here. Students, wave at me, students. We love that you're here. They're giving up the good seats for the bleachers for all of us. Isn't that nice of them? Because their backs can handle it, right, guys? But here's the truth, and I hope you guys are paying attention. We have to understand what the resurrection looks like and sounds like as best we can, not from our ideas, not from movies, not from music, but from the Word of God. So today, I want to give you four quick scriptures that will help you see what the resurrection actually is going to look like. Are you ready for that? Because we live in a world that's fighting to tell you what the resurrection will look like. So what does the Bible teach us about the resurrection? First question we have to ask is, what is it? At its most simplest form, it is a return to life. But what the Bible really talks about is that the final resurrection of all people before their judgment before God. So there's a final resurrection at the last day. Jesus will come back. And there's four quick verses that I want to just read to you. 1 Corinthians 15:52 to 53, it says this. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will all be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. So when you look at that verse, what do we know? I want to draw your attention to a Greek word that's that word changed. Your Bibles might say transformed. That Greek word there is alasso. Say alasso. And alasso, here's what that means. To change, to cause a difference by altering the nature or character of something. It's an exchange substitute from one thing to another. And here's what I want you to see. Right now, this is what you and I look like. The Bible actually says that we see things as though it was like a glass dimly. Now, these sunglasses are out of this world awesome, don't you think? Come on, don't laugh too hard. They're pretty sweet. I know. I'll sell them to you afterwards, all right? $50. No, I'm just kidding. So these sunglasses Tate got before we went to the beach. And before we got there, he'd already broken the lenses out and they were falling apart. And one of the things that happens, I don't know, in our family is sunglasses get lost, broken, or stolen, mostly lost over and over and broken. And so what ends up happening is you go to the beach and it's super bright, beautiful sunny day, and you need sunglasses. Anybody with me? You can't see. Well, these were the sunglasses I ended up wearing that day because he broke them. And the whole time my eyes were hurting and it was hard to pay attention, have fun, and I ended up getting a hat, and then I ended up finally just breaking down and going to a gas station and spending $15 on sunglasses. But here's what I want you to see. The world that you're living in, aren't you grateful for what God's given us? It's amazing, right? So much beauty. But we know that it's nothing comparable to heaven. And not only that, when we get resurrected, our new bodies, our new lives, we will be changed. Anybody else excited about that? Anybody else got a bad back? Like, oh, baby, I'm looking forward to a back free with no pain. So I want to give you a visual. I think our bodies will be changed to something a little bit better. Let's go. Come on, anybody else ready? Too cool for school, if you ask me. But I want you to catch this, because oftentimes I see it and you see it too. People hold on to what's here rather than looking forward to what's there. We're so afraid. What's going to happen to the economy? What's going to happen with our presidency? What's going to happen with our neighbors, with our friends, with our family, with our illness? And we're so afraid. And God's saying, change your lens. You're looking through this world and you're so desperate for here. That's why people are that love God, they put on some new glasses. Hello. And you know what ends up happening to them? They're more generous. Why? Because the Bible says, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy it. And do you know that the more you encounter Jesus, I believe he starts changing you even while you're here. You start to become more like God. You start to become more like his son. Things start changing in you. So the first thing you have to recognize is that there's going to be a transformation. There's going to be a change. Now, the audience that would have listened to this, the Greeks, as they're listening to this, you know what they would have thought right away? Their whole belief system was that the physical body was actually a hindrance. They couldn't wait to die, because what it meant to them was that this body would be gone and that their spirit would go on. It would be like unrecognizable. You were brand new. You'd be like a Greek god. All your muscles would just show up. Okay? Now the Jews, when they're listening to this, what they believed at the resurrection last day is that you get to keep the same body. New life, same look. Over and over and over and over. Jesus shows up and he says, I am the resurrection and the life. And then we read through scripture and he says, no, you're going to be changed. The next thing, Matthew 22:30, it says, at the resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven. Now, for some people, that's really sad because they want to be married forever. For other people, oh, we'll leave that there alone. Depends on the day. But it's just important that we know that. That's why when you read the marriage vows, what does it say? Till death do us part. Why? Because when we go to heaven, we are changed. Our bodies, relationships, and it says like the angels. So we're not given in marriage. Next verse, 2 Corinthians 5:1. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Anybody else think that's really good news? I don't know. I like camping. It's okay. But I can't wait to get back into my house with a bed. I enjoy it for like a day. Oh, wait, real quick, who loves to camp? Raise your hand. Okay, we got some brave souls. Who just can't wait to be in your bed, your pillow, your house, Your shower, anybody else? Come on. Jesus is saying you're going to be moving from a tent to a house. It's going to be amazing. Way better. And Eugene Peterson, who wrote the message, and I just want to be really careful. I see it as a commentary, not like word for word scripture. Everybody okay? Everybody understand that? There was like a lot of controversy. This came out just an expansion. But I like the way he wrote this. He said, this is that verse, 2 Corinthians 5, 1. He says, for instance, we know that when these bodies of ours are taken down, the tents and folded away, they will be replaced by resurrection bodies in heaven, God-made, not handmade, and will never have to relocate our tents again. Sometimes we can hardly wait to move, and so we cry out in frustration compared to what's coming. Living conditions around here seem like a stopover in an unfurnished shack, and we're tired of it. We've been given a glimpse of the real thing, our true home, our resurrection bodies. The Spirit of God whets our appetite by giving us a taste of what's ahead. He puts a little of heaven in our hearts so that we will never settle for less. Anybody else agree with that? Cannot wait for the resurrection. Amen. Last verse, 1 Thessalonians 4:16. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, this is so important. Encourage one another with these words. As a church, do you realize that's what we're supposed to tell each other? You're going to get a new body. You're going to, if you know Jesus and he's transformed you and you said, I believe in him, you're going to follow him all the days of your life. That means one day you're going to be in heaven with the Lord forever. No more tents, just houses. You're going to see clearly. It's going to be brand new, and most of all, you'll be with Jesus forever. It will change everything. Therefore, we don't weep, we don't mourn, we're not sad the way the world mourns, because death is not the final say. Jesus is the final say. And how do we know that? I am the resurrection and the life. Amen? Amen. He is the resurrection and the life. Verse 28, I want to go back to the story, and as we get there, I want you to hear this. Jesus does not merely say that he will bring about the resurrection. He says, it's me. It's him. So watch what happens. After she had said this, this is Martha, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and he is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. How many of us live with ifs? What if God? But only God. If it wouldn't have been that way, my life would have been so much better. If it wouldn't have been, it would have been the story I would have written. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. One of the most comforting verses that we need to pay attention to is right here, the shortest verse in Scripture. If you want to win a junior Bible quiz test someday. Jesus wept. Do you recognize that in your pain, in your sorrow? Because I'm looking at some of the, as I've been here, Mael and I have been here for 19, almost 20 months now. I'm getting to know more and more of your stories, and the amount of people that have lost spouses, the amount of people that have lost friends and family members, a lot of people in here, I start to get to know your story, and I want you to hear this. This is so powerful. Jesus wept. That means Jesus is not some faraway God that doesn't feel your pain, that doesn't care about you. He weeps with us. It says in his spirit, he was deeply troubled. In other words, he wants you to know he's with you in the middle of your storm, in the middle of your pain. Whatever you're facing right now, your emotions may be high or low, he's with you. And he has empathy. What does that mean? He feels it with you. Even though he has the answer, even though he knows the problem, in the moment of your pain, God is with you. Amen. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" We put a pause right there in that story. That's what waiting feels like, doesn't it? Many of you are in that moment right now. And you hear the naysayers, don't you? See, I knew God wouldn't show up. See, I knew he'd disappoint you. See, I knew she wouldn't follow through. See, couldn't even open the eyes of a blind man. Or he opened the blind man, but he can't save Lazarus' friend. Couldn't heal him. All of this is happening. All of this is taking place. And if we're not careful, if we don't guard our hearts, what's going to happen? Sadness, bitterness, disappointment. Resentment. We're in a dangerous place. But I want you to hear this. Mary and Martha wanted a healing, but Jesus came for a resurrection. Mary and Martha wanted a healing, but Jesus came for a resurrection. Anybody else thankful that what I prayed for, Jesus did something better? Anybody else grateful that God's not done with your story? Anybody else grateful that God sees you exactly where you are and he's not surprised? Many of you know this, but over 4 weeks ago, we had a pipe burst in our sanctuary. Water flooded, destroyed the carpet, classrooms, walls. And what most people would probably say, yes, I understand, but didn't know this, but this church has been around for 100 years. This year. So on the 100th year, a pipe bursts. The enemy would want us to put these natural glasses on, because the Bible says that you and I are, we have the sinful nature, but we can live by the Spirit. You see, in the natural, you put on lenses and you wonder, where's God? We have to meet in a gym. How much is that going to cost? And there are people here that have had weddings and seen things happen and funerals, met Jesus, been a part of a move of God in that sanctuary, and it looked and it felt the same. But then things get changed. Do I look at it from the natural and think, God, where are you? Or do I flip it around and say, God, you're here. You're at work. I don't know how it's going to work out, but I trust you. You've been with me. You see, this location, that Portland Christian Center on, do you know this is our third location? Did you know that? It started out in a house and a barn. The Vetches started a small group, and it grew and it grew. Then they went to another building. Then they finally bought that middle where we are right now. But do you know this gym was the second iteration of this building? Some of you are like, yeah, I know. I was here. I helped pay for it. And here's what the enemy wants you to think. there's no way this church is going forward. Look, I'm making a pipe burst. Look, there's going to be upheaval. There's going to be struggle. And I think that there's enough people in this room that believe God that when he says, I can do exceedingly, abundantly, above all you ever ask, think, or imagine. Ephesians 3:20, it is time for the people of God to stand up in faith and say, we have a God that can raise the dead to life. Yeah. And just because we're a little bit discomforted right now, I think it's actually a good thing. Why? Because it has nothing to do with the carpet. We don't even have carpet in this room. It has everything to do with the presence of God. And we're going to do our best to make it look as beautiful and God-honoring and most inviting we possibly can. But everyone in this room, I want you to hear me. It's about the presence of God. And it will always be about the presence of God. Because he's the one that changes everything. The worst thing that we can do is put on our natural glasses in a time like this. Why? If God has to meet your expectation, then you don't have room for him to exceed your expectations. I'm going to say that again. If God has to meet your expectations, you don't have room for him to exceed your expectations. Are you expecting God to only do what you ask? Or are you asking him to still be God? You see, I think some of us need to change the way that we pray. God, I know you're God, but let me tell you what I think you should do. What if we came back to this place of humility and said, God, this doesn't look right. That doesn't look right. They certainly don't look right. But I trust you. I have faith that the same God who can raise Lazarus from the dead can do a work in my life. Verse 43, when he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And I love this part. It says, the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and the cloth around his face. Anybody else thankful the dead man came out? Jesus is the resurrection and the life. You should have been handed communion on your way in. Does everybody have communion? Why don't you grab it and go ahead and hold it up? That'd be awesome. Hold up your communion elements. Thank you, Mayal. Hold it up. If you don't have it, raise your hand and the ushers will run it as fast as they can to make sure everybody has one. Do you realize communion reminds us of this power? Jesus is the resurrection and the life. What are you facing today where you're disappointed that God didn't meet your expectation? God didn't show up the way you wanted him to show up. And I want to encourage you, allow him to exceed your expectations. Your situation may have missed your expectation, but I want you to hear this. If you'll stay with Jesus, he'll give you a new revelation of who he is. If your situation does not meet your expectation, Jesus will be the revelation that your heart desires. You see, communion, you can go ahead and flip it over and grab the, make sure you open the bread side first. I have to remind people, sometimes that gets a little difficult. Open it up. His body broken for you. We prayed this morning for people that maybe you're newer to church or you haven't been around, but or maybe you walked away, but we've been praying for people to come back to God. Before we take communion, you have to know that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And the hope that you're looking for is always found in him. It's not just an event. It's a person who has the power to make the events happen. So I want to give you a moment before we receive communion. If you're here today and you want to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior to be the resurrection and the life, right where you're seated, will you just slip up your hand And I want to pray for you that you want to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior before you take communion. It's so important. You don't have to be a member. Thank you. I see that hand. That's awesome. Come on. Anybody else? Thank you. That's so good. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else? Hey, see that hand over there. Let's go. Come on. I think there's more. Thank you. Thank you. Maybe online, put it in the chat. Anybody else? We don't want to leave anybody out. Come on. Yeah, I see those hands. That's so good. Cool. You can put your hands down. And I would like everybody to pray this prayer with me. First of all, let's clap for the people that raised their hands. That's so good. Thank you, Jesus. So good. I guess it is kind of hard to clap with bread in your hands, but hopefully nobody's wafer flew out of their hands. Would you pray with me? And let's just repeat this prayer after me. Every person, nobody left out so that the person doesn't feel singled out. Say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash me and make me clean. I put my trust in you. I believe that you are the resurrection and the life. I'm going to follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, let's give the Lord just a shout of praise. God, we thank you. Praise your name, Lord, for all those that received you. If you would hold the bread up, Lord, we thank you for your body that was broken for us. Thank you that you paid the penalty once and for all. I pray right now in Jesus' name that every single person here this morning, whether online or here, would put their trust and confidence in you. Thank you for your body that was broken for us. We take heed of it in remembrance of you. Let's take together. The Bible says after supper, he took the cup of the new covenant. And what this means is that his body, his blood, was spilled for us. And it says that it washes our sins white as snow. Anybody else thankful for a fresh start? I don't know about you, but I am so grateful that God gives me a fresh start. The times that I walk in my flesh and I make mistakes and I sin, God forgives me. He washes me white as snow. And he does that for all of us this morning. Are you grateful? Thank you, Jesus. So hold the cup up and say, thank you, Jesus, for your blood that was spilled for us, that washes us white as snow, that gives us direct access to you, Heavenly Father. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.